Hello all, and welcome to this online event. The event will be in English with simultaneous interpreting provided in Portuguese and Spanish. Please feel free to choose a language in the taskbar on Zoom or keep the field original audio selected. If you have any problems, please let us know in the chat function. Our technical staff will help you with any issues you have. My name is Cassia Hare and I'm the Counsellor for Education and Science at the Australian Embassy in Brazil. I've been with the Australian government for around 12 years with experience in Indigenous and social policy programs, as well as vocational and technical education. I only arrived in Brasília in September this year, and I've been so pleased and excited to see all of the amazing work that's happening, particularly with our Centre for Internationalization of Education, Brazil, Australia. Today, I'll be your Master of Ceremonies on the first Latin American Symposium on Opportunities and Challenges for Internationalizing the Curriculum at Home. This symposium is promoted by the Centre of Internationalization of Education, Brazil, Australia, through the Project on Internationalization of Higher Education in Latin America, funded by the Council on Australian-Latin American Relationships, or COALA. This project is being developed in partnership with Curtin University and La Trobe University. One of its main goals is to connect practitioners and researchers in higher education internationalization and internationalization of the curriculum at home in Latin America, Australia, and globally. That's why we're so glad to have you here in this event. After the presentation of our guest speakers, we'll have time for discussion with all participants. However, you're welcome to use the chat function to make comments or ask questions during the sessions. We also invite you to introduce yourselves, the institution you come from, and your country of origin in the chat. We'd like to thank the following colleagues: Dr. Christina Elsner, Education Manager at the Australian Embassy in Brazil, and through her, extend our thanks to the Australian Embassy team for their support in this project. Professor Dr. Marila Morrisoni, Coordinator of the Centre of Internationalization of Education Brazil Australia, Professor Betty Lisk, Emeritus Professor at La Trobe University, Dr. Craig Whitstead, Senior Lecturer at the Curtin University, and Carla Castle, Executive Coordinator of PUCRS Office for International Cooperation and Researcher at the Centre of Internationalization of Education Brazil Australia. We would also like to thank our guest speakers, Dr. Lee Tran, Professor at Deakin University and the Australian Research Council Future Fellow, Dr. Maria Veronica Benya, author and tutor in the Curriculum Internationalization Diploma of the Inter-American Organization for Higher Education, Coordinator of Ecuadorian Higher Education Internationalization Network, and Professor, Researcher, and Internationalization Director of Universidad Católica de Santiago de Guayaquil, Ecuador. Dr. Gerardo Blanco, Associate Professor and Academic Director for the Center of International Higher Education at Boston College in the United States. We'd also like to thank all of our other representatives of the Australian government, professors, researchers, students, representatives of other universities, associations, and institutions for attending this event. This first symposium is focused on exploring challenges and opportunities for the internationalization of curriculum at home. And the reason for choosing this topic is that only 3% of all undergraduate students from Latin America have the chance to study abroad or take part in an exchange program. Opportunities exist, but they're restrictive, either due to language barriers or budget constraints. The work of the Centre aims to promote a more democratic access to international and intercultural experiences at home. To open this debate, I'd like to invite Dr. Craig Whitstead, Senior Lecturer at Curtin University, to deliver his opening speech. Thanks, Craig.
Thank you very much for that fantastic introduction, Cassia. And thank you everybody for joining us this morning, or this evening. And I'd just like to start by saying, g'day, how are you? That's a very Australian greeting. I could go with konnichiwa, mina genki desu ka. That's Japanese, hello, hope you're all well. I'd really like to start by saying is this last couple of years have been extremely challenging because COVID has been about separating and isolating us in ways that possibly a couple of years ago we might not have been able to imagine. And one of the things that I really feel passionate about with respects to internationalization and internationalization of the curriculum is that it's all about bringing us together. and connections, and how we can then develop the sort of resources that we need to confront the challenges of today. I'd really like to thank each of our guest speakers. Lee, thank you very much. I'm really looking forward to what you have to say about internationalization in the Vietnamese context. Gerardo, thank you very much for joining us from Boston. And I'm really looking forward to hearing about the perspectives that you'll bring on internationalization. And Maria, thank you very much too for what you'll be doing in terms of talking about the networks and internationalization of the curriculum. I think that's a very important dimension that doesn't necessarily get addressed when we start thinking about how we approach curriculum internationalization. So it's a fantastic opportunity for everybody here to get some really interesting perspectives on what I think is a really important dimension of higher education across the globe. So I'd also like to extend my thanks to the Australian government and DFAT, the department that has funded our project and made it possible for us to present this symposia, and particularly our team. And one person I really want to mention is someone who's behind the scenes that we don't get to see much, but without her fantastic work, certainly we wouldn't have the opportunity that we have today. So Thais, thank you very much. And the team that you are working with, thank you again for all your fantastic support and particularly organisation. So with that, welcome everybody, and thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Dr. Whitsett. Your work at the Centre for Internationalisation of Education, Brazil, Australia, is central to the success of this symposium and to fostering the creation of a Latin American network of experts and researchers on this topic. Now I'm pleased to invite Ms. Carla Castle, Executive Coordinator of the PUCRS Office for International Cooperation and researcher at the Centre of Internationalisation of Education, Brazil, Australia, to deliver her opening remarks.
Thank you, Cássia. Thank you very much. Actually, I'm going to address my speech in Portuguese. Então, boa noite, boa tarde, bom dia a todos e todas, dependendo de onde estão. É com satisfação que a Pontifícia Universidade Católica do Rio Grande do Sul recebe a todos nesse evento. Sejam todos e todas muito bem-vindos. O primeiro simpósio latino-americano de oportunidades e desafios para a internacionalização do currículo em casa dialoga muito com o contexto atual, onde espera-se das universidades novas interfaces com a sociedade e entregas para a mesma. Não se trata apenas de promover a formação de profissionais competentes para o mercado de trabalho, mas sim ser a promotora do desenvolvimento de uma sociedade alicerçada no tripé da sustentabilidade. Ou seja, uma sociedade economicamente viável, ecologicamente correta e socialmente justa, por meio da formação de cidadãos globais. Egressos capazes de atuar profissionalmente no atual mundo globalizado e interconectado em que vivemos, mas igualmente conscientes das suas responsabilidades como cidadãos do mundo, com perspectivas globais e competências interculturais devidamente desenvolvidas. Trata-se, portanto, do compromisso com a formação de pessoas comprometidas com a cidadania, corresponsáveis pelos destinos humanos. O objetivo desse projeto, desenvolvido em parceria com universidades e colegas da Austrália, é justamente desenvolver essas competências interculturais e perspectivas internacionais nos alunos da educação superior aqui na nossa América Latina, através da internacionalização do currículo. É uma resposta à urgente necessidade que temos de novas abordagens, estratégias e projetos de internacionalização da educação que a tornem mais inclusiva. Em muitas universidades ainda, a mobilidade acadêmica é vista como sinônimo de internacionalização. No entanto, mundialmente, de acordo com a própria OCDE, ainda antes da pandemia, em 2019, menos de 5% do total de alunos matriculados em educação superior têm a oportunidade de fazer mobilidade. E aqui na América Latina o cenário é ainda pior, menos de 3%. Se essa é a única oportunidade que os nossos alunos têm para desenvolver perspectivas internacionais e competências interculturais, essas que lhes são muito exigidas, estamos falhando. Precisamos sim garantir que todos os nossos alunos tenham essa oportunidade. E a internacionalização do currículo traz essa possibilidade,
pois inclui a internacionalização na missão principal da educação superior, que é o processo de ensino e aprendizagem. Eu agradeço aos colegas da PUC, da Embaixada da Austrália no Brasil, dos colegas pesquisadores envolvidos na organização desse evento, e destaco quão importante tem sido a histórica parceria entre a PUC Rio Grande do Sul e instituições australianas, especialmente depois da criação do nosso Centro de Internacionalização da Educação Brasil-Austrália. Que nossas relações sigam se fortalecendo e ampliando o nosso olhar conjunto para as possibilidades culturais, acadêmicas, econômicas e sociais que envolvem nossos países no aspecto local e global. Um agradecimento especial à doutora Litran, doutora Maria Verônica Penha e também ao doutor Gerardo Blanco, que nos brindarão com o compartilhamento dos seus conhecimentos. E muito importante, obrigada a vocês que estão aqui conosco, que acreditam nessa proposta, que fazem parte desse networking e que farão a diferença nas suas universidades, aplicando a proposta de internacionalização do currículo e transformando a nossa sociedade. Que tenhamos um excelente simpósio. Obrigada. Cássia?
Thank you so much, Ms. Castle. We're so delighted to have PUCRS as a partner for the Australian Embassy in Brazil and in Latin America. Before starting the first session, I'd like to highlight that if you want to receive a certificate of attendance for this event, please click on the link we're just sending in the chat right now. Now we'd like to invite Dr. Lee Tran, Professor at Deakin University and an Australian Research Council Future Fellow, to deliver the session on IoC at Home in Vietnam. Dr. Tran's research focuses on international education, international students, student mobility, international student graduate employability, the education migration nexus, Australian students learning in the Indo-Pacific region via the New Colombo Plan, and staff professional learning in international education. She also undertakes research on higher education, vocational training, and graduate employability in Vietnam and China. Welcome, Dr. Tran.
Good morning, everyone from Melbourne, and a very warm welcome to our symposium. First of all, I would like to convey my gratefulness for the opportunity to share with you some insight into internationalization of the curriculum at home in Vietnam. And let me start by sharing my screen. Can you see the screen now?
Yes, we can. Thanks, Lee.
Thank you. So before talking about internationalization of the curriculum at home in Vietnam, I'd like to share with you some insights about the background of internationalization in Vietnam, in which internationalization of the curriculum is embedded. So international education in Vietnam has been closely shaped by the economic and political circumstances of the nation, especially prior to 1990, internationalization in Vietnam was heavily influenced by the principle from China, France, the US, and the socialist countries, the former socialist countries, especially the former Western bloc, like Russia. And during this period, internationalization happened when Vietnam was colonized, dominated, and controlled, or strongly affected by foreign countries. But interestingly, at the same time, the country resisted those foreign forces and tried to creatively adapt internationalization in order to be more suitable to the Vietnamese context. And Vietnam has the National Strategy for Educational Development, and in which internationalization has been identified as one of the 8 pillars that have to lift the quality and standard of higher education in Vietnam. And internationalization has been positioned as one of the key vehicles in order to enhance the nation's human capital. And also, it is seen as a tool in order to have the country with regional and global connection and integration, especially the period after the Vietnam War. And internationalization is considered as a mechanism in order to boost education quality and catch up with the what is called the standard within the region and the world. Now I would like to move to discussing one of the key initiatives of internationalization of the curriculum in Vietnam. It's called the Advanced Program. So the Advanced Program is considered as a signature initiative of internationalization in Vietnam. And the program aims to offer advanced education in chosen discipline at selected university in accordance with the world standard, and to ensure the quality of teaching and learning to be regionally and internationally recognized. And one of the key ambitions attached to the advanced program is for some selected Vietnamese universities, some top tier Vietnamese university, to be in the world top 200 university by 2020. And that was proved to be too ambitious and unachievable by the time then. And last but not least, one of the key goals of the advanced program is to help to boost the quality of the Vietnamese workforce, especially for a competitive regional and international labor market. And the advanced program has a pilot period between 2006 and 2008. And during that period, altogether 17 programs were implemented, among which 14 was in partnership with American University and 3 was in partnership with UK University. And all these partnership university was in the world's 100 university in the world. And after the pilot program, the partnership university was also expanded to include Australian University, for instance, University of Sydney. And the budget for the pilot period was around $40 million for 3 years. And since 2008, the advanced program was expanded and implemented with a broader number of university across different parts of the country, so including central Vietnam, as well as the northern mountainous region of Vietnam, like Thai Nguyen University. And one of the key features of the advanced program is English is used as a medium of instruction. And in terms of the teaching force in the advanced program, the first cohort of each advanced program has been required to be taught by foreign academics, mainly academics from the UK, US, and Australia, or by foreign-based academics of Vietnamese origins. Then gradually, Vietnamese academics took over the job of teaching. Now, I would like to look at the context of internationalizing the curriculum via the advanced program from a political perspective. So, as you can see, one of the core principles of the advanced program is to adopt foreign curriculum. And it has been seen as a quick fix approach by adopting what has been proven as good practice or best practice in curriculum internationalization in the world and bring it into the context of Vietnam. But it is still subject to the curriculum standard of the Vietnamese government, in this case, the Ministry of Education and Training. So within that foreign curriculum, there's a requirement to integrate a 10 credit political modules into the imported curricula. And this 10 credit module include three key components. The first one is Marxism and Leninism. The second one is Ho Chi Minh thoughts. And the third one is the history and approaches of the Communist Party of Vietnam. The first component, Marxism and Leninism, covers socialism, communism, capitalism, economic doctrines, as well as democracy. Ho Chi Minh thoughts covers the ideologies under Ho Chi Minh principle of communism, socialism, liberalism, nationalism, which is one of the key priorities. And the third one, as I mentioned, would address the history and approaches of the Communist Party of Vietnam. And in addition to these, so the other component of the curriculums will be imported from foreign curriculums in the US, UK, and Australia. And those components, those foreign components also contain ideological principle shaped by the Western histories and belief and ideologies. So in our research, academics and students reported a number of clashes between Vietnamese and Western political ideologies. However, if we look at a broader context, we will see that the internationalization at home in Vietnam through the introduction of the advanced program has reflected the country dual orientation of capitalism and socialism. So some of you may be aware of one of the key milestones in Vietnamese economic and social reform called Đổi Mới, and it was initiated in 1986 in order to bring Vietnam to the world. So the open door policy that moved country from a subsidized centralized socialist economy to a socialist oriented multiple sector market economy, quite long, but you can see the transition into a socialist oriented capitalist economy. And the advanced program through internationalization of the curriculum also reflect that dual orientation by bringing in a lot of capitalist principle, but at the same time retaining the political modules of socialism. And the roles of the communist as well as the Confucian values and principle act as a filter for the implementation of internationalization of the curriculum in Vietnam and the filter for the appropriation of foreign influences in Vietnamese university and for localization of the borrowed foreign practices. And in our latest publication just last month, we reported various challenges experienced by academic and student, but one of the key findings is that the coexistence of both the socialist and capitalist ideology as well as the classes in the curriculum potentially assist students to develop multiple frame of references and the ability to critically analyze different political and economic principles using multiple frame of references. Okay, now I have a couple of more minutes. I would like to quickly go through the key achievements of internationalization of the curriculum via the advanced program. So the MOAC target of having at least 30 advanced programs across the sector by the end of 2015 was met 3 years earlier than planned. And the facilities at participating university have been upgraded. For those students and academics who are part of the advanced program, they have the opportunity to be exposed to what is called internationally recognized curriculum content and intellectual environment. But as I mentioned before, it's mainly the curriculum content imported from the US, UK, and Australia. And English is a key medium of instruction for the advanced program. This form of internationalized curriculum gives both students and academics who are pitching into the program the opportunity to enhance their English proficiency, and for student research has documented their employability has been advanced compared to the other cohort. And clearly, the advanced program is a vehicle for selected Vietnamese university to strengthen the partnership with foreign university in the UK, US, and Australia. However, there are some significant concerns with the advanced program, especially in terms of how it is being fragmented and narrow. As I mentioned before, only some discipline and some selected university was involved and funded in the advanced program. So the impacts that I outlined earlier was only for a small proportion of students and small faculties and discipline within university and a number of limited university. And overall, the underlying principle that guides the advanced program is very much shaped by a neo-colonial approach. So imposing a so-called the best practice system on that of the others. And it's also interesting to reflect on the long history of internationalization in Vietnam together with the historical milestone of the country. So clearly during the Vietnam War, the education system in Vietnam was influenced by US, so we often refer to US imperialism or US colonization. So after the reunification of the country and the withdrawal of the US troops, the educational system worked toward decolonization. But with the advanced program, there are traces of recolonization. And this model of internationalization of the curriculum stand in isolation with the other programs within the same institution. And it go against the holistic institutional capacity to at home internationalization. In terms of access equity, the advanced program tend to privilege students from affluent families with satisfactory command of English and excellent academics. So we may be aware that Vietnam is a socialist country. So higher education is largely subsidized by the government, but with the advanced program, the fee is many times higher than other mainstream programs. So only students from quite relatively well-off family can afford the advanced program. And students from rural and disadvantaged background are more likely to be excluded from the advanced program. So my last slide, some key aspects to consider is how the Western and external education models and practices have been tailored in order to be suitable to local needs in a developing country like Vietnam. And here I would like to bring forward the notion of how to use to draw on creative borrowing versus passive borrowing in transnational internationalization of the curriculums, and how significant it is to pay attention to reciprocal learning in transnational internationalization of the curriculum, and the notion of de-Westernization of practices, including the use of Vietnamese values as asset in internationalization of the curriculum. And most importantly, I think it's the issue of equity and sustainability once the funding period has expired in internationalization at home in the context of Vietnam. And with that note of equity and sustainability, I would like to wrap up my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Cassia.
For your incredibly interesting presentation. Now I would like to invite Dr. Maria Veronica Benya. You're still sharing your screen.
Yep, I stopped sharing.
Okay. Great. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Maria Veronica Benya, author and tutor in the curriculum of Internationalization Diploma of the Inter-American Organization for Higher Education, coordinator of the Ecuadorian Higher Education Internationalization Network, and professor, researcher, and internationalization director at the Universidad Católica de Santiago de Guayaquil, Ecuador, to deliver the session on connective internationalization, the curriculum in the network society. Dr. Peña has a PhD in methodologies for the design, evaluation, and improvement of plans, projects, and educational programs. She served as the Andean country's regional executive secretary of the Inter-American Organization for Higher Education, that granted her the 2019 Gillies-Boulle Prize, awarded to the best innovative project whose theme referred to leadership and management of international knowledge and networks. Welcome, Dr. Peña.
Thank you so much for that nice introduction. Y saludos para todos desde la Universidad Católica de Santiago de Guayaquil en Ecuador. Today, I will present Connective Internationalization, the curriculum in the network society. So this approach for internationalization was born in 2018 with my colleague Claudia Ponte from Colombia, while we were working at one of the international organization of higher education OE programs. It was the DS, that's the diploma in higher education internationalization. It ran for, at that time, it was running for 9 years, and 1,000 professionals from 133 universities in 23 countries had participated. Most of them were international department personnel. And when we spoke about internationalization in those inter-American universities, the most important part of it that they said that they were working at was at planning in an institutional level. But they were focused in making contacts with international universities in order to have agreements. But those agreements had a limited international participation in research or in other kinds of projects. And especially, they have a minimal teacher participation in those programs. When they spoke about internationalization of curriculums, they focused especially in student international mobility. And when we asked them if there was some theoretical approach to internationalization, they said there was none, even though universities are the crypt of science and creation of new theories. So some of them spoke about a systems approach being focused in the planning or in their planification, but the methodology and the linear strategies that they were applying to the activities didn't reflect such an approach. They were using a linear approach in education, cause effect, a teacher that teaches, a student that learns. A teacher is active, the student is passive. And also in planning, they have the same kind of method. They were searching for goals in a linear direction. But when we talk about education, it's a complex process. It's a recursive process, a communicational process. There are flows of influence and interdependence. And we observe patterns that are repeated over and over again. So this idea of organization pattern is it's a special idea in the connective approach for internationalization. And also we are watching a circular causality. There are lots of dimensions, problems, and factors and criteria that are mixed in the education as a process. So the epistemological foundations for connective internationalization, I can begin speaking of quoting Capra, that says that systems thinking is a network thinking. And from Chile, Maturana and Varela add that autopoiesis is the circular organization of the living. So life has a network pattern. Luhmann, sociologist, said that society is essentially communications between people, not the people themselves. And the pattern of society is a communicational network. Universities are societies, organizations. So education has a communication pattern. Bateson, one of the fathers of the systems theory, said that systems have an organizing principle that has a connecting pattern, whose most important property is its network form. And Václavik, another of the systems theory fathers, said that you cannot communicate. So patterns, communication are foundations of the epistemology in connective internationalization. So the networks is another of the important parts, and we begin defining a net. So it's an open mesh fabric, twisted, knotted, or woven together at regular intervals. But the etiology of complexus, complex, also has a similar meaning, a whole consisting of interconnected or interwoven parts. So nets and complex have a similar definition. So networks from the computing or technology world has a definition that says that it's a simultaneous connection to a main system. And this idea of centered, of focused, of middle is something that it's also fine in the strategic networks that we do alliances with other partners that have different missions, maybe another faculty member or maybe another university department, a different university in another country, in order to cooperate. And our planning has different independent activities that focus on that main purpose in the middle. And everyone goes by a different way to that, to obtain that goal or to cooperate in order to obtain that goal. But we're looking forward to connective networks, the ones that we have in our brain, our cells making synapses in that electrochemical moment, transmitting communication, information. And that's how our brain works, and technologies make something similar in the social in the society. So those are social networks. And Castells, I quote him when he says that we are networks. There's our DNA that has a network pattern connected to a networking world. So connective internationalization, the concept, is an organization pattern in higher education institution dynamics, but there has conceptualized as complex systems. They form connections internal inside the university or with the external world in order to create networks. And those networks achieve learning and knowledge. That's the idea of internationalization. And we think that that curriculum is the university's program, the whole program. So this is an emerging paradigm from linear causality to circular causality, from strategic alliances to network. Of course, we will still do work in strategic alliances. That depends on the goal, which will be the goal in order to have a partnership. If our goal is to optimize resources, maintaining our independency, and so we cooperate. And the etymology of that word comes with opus in Latin, that means ouvre, the work, the job being done. So we work together in order to obtain that middle focused goal. But in networks, we have system thinking, an ecological approach, and complexity also. So we collaborate, and the etymology is the laborare, that Latin work that focus working together, but in the process of combining, recombining, and co-constructing the products and the process education in this kind, or the curriculum. So learning networks are internal networks like the ones that we have in our neuronal system, where we have perceptions and cognitions, we have ideas that they recombine, they make synapses, and we have concepts that they also can combine with another concept, and that's how we produce science. And we can connect them to nodes of different nature, nodes that could be physical as books, as institutions, persons, or they could be technological as databases or the World Wide Web or social networks, in order to find information that we process and do the learning process, and new the product will be knowledge. The connectivism theory has those principles, and the principle is that learning is done through the process of connecting nodes of sources of information. The objective of education is train students to be producers of their own knowledge, so the teacher won't be teaching anymore. They have to show, motivate the students to develop the ability to connect with the sources that have the required information. The teacher knows which blog, web page that students could go to and search for the information they need to construct or to create knowledge. The teacher's role is to tutor and network and administrate the network to encourage the students to make the new connections and to facilitate collaborative working together. The student will be interactive, critical. He has to build his own personal learning network, making connections using technologies. So the process of the connective internationalization begins with each one of us. Teachers, in order to teach students, have to make the personal learning network. And that means to focus, Goldman and Peter Drucker, they talk about focusing in order to pursue something. So we focus first in ourselves, make self-awareness, which are the nodes that I get information for my professional life, for my hobbies, for my music, maybe Spotify, there to watch a movie, and I go to Netflix, and we have to get that in order to have clear which are those nodes or persons where I get information from. And then there's a second level of internationalization inside the university, the institution, where I have focused on empathy, and I'm not making connections with people from other departments in order to work interdisciplinary projects. That's the goal. And the third and more complex connection in this process is the community of practices, where we have to focus on a systems thinking, connecting the local with the global in order to create networks and to produce new products in internationalization. I have the International Organization of Higher Education as in the middle of it, because the connective internationalization of the curriculum was born during those courses. Everything is working in the system's key criteria. This, every system, no matter which one, even biological or society systems, have three criteria. Structure, it would say that we have a communicational pattern, so communication is part of the system's structure, what the system is. The people that work in the system, the rules that the people have, and also the resources. And in part of the structure, one of the main important parts is values. So the processes is what a system does in order to get to those goals. Different system, different goals, but each one has a leader that takes the decisions, and they have flows of information, flows that in an educational system will be always be learning and knowledge. Then the management, the feedback, exams, assessment and crisis. Of course, coronavirus has been a world crisis for every system. And the pattern is how they do it. Quality is inside the pattern when those two structures are functioning together. Those are the essential features, the identity, the institutional seal of we are an international institution. What kind of patterns, how can we say which qualities we have in order to say that a learning environment, that an institution or maybe a career has those criteria that permit them to say that they are internationalized curriculum. So the internationalization of the curriculum search for that pattern of a communicational network in three dimensions, and the methodology, we have created criteria, we have created, we give them in the tools different ideas in order to make self-awareness and self-assessment. It's not a model in order to assess institutions, but to plan the institutions with the criteria that they need. So internationalization of a curriculum with a connective approach have the same mainstream of internationalization of the curriculum that incorporates international, intercultural, interdisciplinary approaches, active methodologies, but the difference is that it promotes the creation of learning and knowledge networks that could contribute from the education to generate global citizen and sustainable lifestyles as the the sustainable development goals ask for. And to do this, to be part of a global citizen, to feel part of a common humanity, needs to have a structure in values. Values that we're talking today, like solidarity, equity, tolerance, all of those are the deep regulatory structures that organize the communicational pattern of any social system, and of course, universities and its curriculum. So in order to end my presentation, internationalization of the curriculum in Latin America has to think or to incorporate values in this actual network society. And I quote Edgar Morin when he says that today, the fundamental global objective of all education is the survival of humanity. After this pandemic, I hope that all of us will emerge more humans. And the education of the future should teach ethics of the planetary understanding, making conscious, be conscious of those values that will make us human again through internationalization of our curriculum. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Benya, for your presentation and your support for this Latin American network of researchers. I would now like to invite Dr. Gerardo Blanco, Associate Professor and Academic Director for the Center for International Higher Education at Boston College, United States, to deliver his session on the latest developments for quality in international education. Dr. Blanco is a Fulbright Specialist and an American Council on Education Advisor. His research explores the intersections of quality and internationalization in higher education. He earned his doctorate from the University of Massachusetts Amherst. In 2014, 2017, and 2020, he received research awards from the Comparative and International Education Society, and he has published more than 30 journal articles on higher education topics. Born in Mexico, he has taught or conducted research in over 15 different countries. Welcome, Dr. Blanco.
Thank you very much. It really is such a pleasure to be with all of you. I want to make sure that you're able to see my screen, but hopefully not my notes. Please tell me if you can see my notes.
We cannot see your notes, just the presentation.
Excellent, that's great. Well, thank you so much for this invitation. It really is such a pleasure to be with all of you. The At the Center for International Higher Education at Boston College, the themes that bring us together this evening or morning really have had a significance for a long, long time. A few years ago, we had the great fortune of having Professor Betty Lesk with us, and I know that she is in this very call, and really her insights that were well ahead of world events at the time were really crucial for positioning internationalization of the curriculum at the center of our research agenda. As well, our previous director, Hans De Witt, also had been working on internationalization at home, primarily from the European perspective, but certainly Latin America has been a very important region for our work. So as academic director of the Center for International Higher Education, I am strongly committed to continue this research agenda on internationalization of the curriculum and also to maintain our networks in Latin America. Being from Mexico, I have kept up with developments both in North America, also in Latin America. And the ideas that I'm going to be sharing with all of you really incorporate some of these perspectives. Most recently, I had the opportunity to spend some time in Colombia as a Fulbright specialist at the Pontificia Universidad Javeriana in Cali. And there I also had the perspective, right, the opportunity to kind of reflect about some of these ideas that I'm going to be sharing with all of you. So I really want to summarize the main points of my presentation in the following, right? First of all, I think when we think about internationalizing the curriculum at home in Latin America, we need to think about the connection with quality and quality assurance practices. I think that's crucial. I think based on this assumption, we need to look at least two practices that are very important and that have been the focus of my research. First of all, accreditation. Secondly, rankings. And also, I am afraid that we may be encountering right now what could become a missed opportunity for internationalizing the curriculum at home. And I will try to offer a few directions for future, both research, but also practice. I think one of the assumptions that we really need to explore is what I like to call the 15% rule. What you can see on the graph on the left of your screen is a story that many of us as higher education practitioners and researchers are already familiar with. The notion, right, that over time, over the last several decades, there has been a significant increase in enrollment in post-secondary education. Of course, I see this as a very favorable development, but also having studied the topic of quality in higher education, one of the stories that we very often hear about is that it was around the 1990s that the countries that at that point didn't have some kind of system for quality assurance of higher education started developing that. So from the perspective of this data, I wanted to look at, well, what else was happening at that during that period of time. So if you look at the horizontal axis of the graph, you can see decade by decade, right, in increments of 5 years or so. And then on the vertical axis, what you see is the percentage of the cohort of the age cohort enrolled in post-secondary education. So then if you look at around 1995, which is fair to say is mid-1990s, that is exactly when the world, the whole enrollment in the world was just getting around that 15% that I'm talking about. So why do I think this matters to be shared with all of you? I am afraid that what this 15% rule indicates is that there seems to be an assumption that as long as higher education remains the privilege of the few, below that 15%, then the question of quality isn't so relevant. In a way, the assumption for the longest time was that quality was built as long into the system, as long as not too many people had access to it. I am afraid that this idea of quality is precisely what's getting in the way of adopting more broadly an internationalization of the curriculum approach in not only Latin America, but in general. And I think this assumption, until we truly contend with this idea, I'm afraid we may not get very, very far in our goals. And I think that's why it deserves some attention. So now let me tell you what I'm observing from the perspective of these two practices, accreditation on the one hand and rankings on the other, and why I believe this is leading us to what seems to be a missed opportunity. So just a very brief overview of accreditation. There are primarily two types. One could accredit a whole institution, a university or college, or one could accredit a program, which we also sometimes call specialized accreditation. In the case of institutional accreditation, generally speaking, we talk about national frameworks, national accrediting agencies. Of course, there are certain exceptions to the rule. Of course, the US has to be an exception to that, where we don't have a national system, but rather we have multiple regional systems in place for accrediting institutions. And on the programmatic side of accreditation, we have highly specialized accreditation. For example, within engineering, we have ABET and other forms of accreditation. So after taking a look at what is happening in the region, particularly in Mexico and Colombia, which are some of the cases that I know more closely, but also looking at what is happening, particularly in the United States, what I'm noticing, right, is that the how of accreditation, the way that accreditation is conducted, adapted very, very quickly. So for example, this idea of virtual site visits was rapidly adopted, but also very quickly, there was this rush to return to in-person visits. But also there were certain good practices around these virtual site visits. Some of the deans of different faculties or schools sort of identified how to be successful in these virtual site visits. And they developed, you know, very well developed, very well organized virtual site visits for the purposes of accreditation. However, the standards, the curriculum that leads to accreditation remained vastly unchanged. And altered, and here I am quoting the website of the Higher Learning Commission, which is one of the US regional accrediting agencies. So the changes that took place were simply to adjust the what they call normal operations to protect the health and safety of their campus communities while providing alternative methods of instructional activity. So what I'm reading in these messages and in comparing the language from different accreditors, what we observe is essentially the message of don't get used to the new normal, we'll go back to the old normal as soon as we can. And this, of course, is not very promising for internationalization either. It could actually become a significant challenge. The ranking story is not at all different. Even in 2021, where there was time to adapt the methodology, we know there are rankings that exist at the national level, but most often global rankings received increased attention in higher education. So two, you know, this is not an intended to be a detailed comparison, but two of the most frequently cited global rankings maintained their methodologies vastly unchanged, even in light of the pandemic. So for example, the Times Higher Education Ranking gives 7.5% of their assessment to what they call an international outlook. And this is distributed equally among students, 2.5%, staff, 2.5%, and collaboration, international collaboration, that is 2.5%. Another global ranking, QS, gives also 5% sort of weight to of the ranking to the ratio of international faculty, and another 5% to the ratio of international students. So what I would like to pose as questions, right, is, do rankings account for international students who remained home, for example, during the pandemic? What sense do we make of stranded academics, many of whom have not been able to return to the countries where they had been working before the pandemic, and yet they remain on the faculty rosters, right? They remain on the payroll, and by all measures, they continue to be counted in these rankings. But also, and perhaps most importantly, are virtual exchange or collaborative online international learning initiatives accounted in any way, whether that is in rankings or also on accreditation? So I think these are important questions for all of us to ponder. Sort of looking around, I really think what we have is a deficit of recognition of the transformation of internationalization that we are witnessing. In the United States, the Paul Simon Award for Comprehensive Internationalization is one of these initiatives, right, that is intended to reward innovative thinking in internationalization. And I was very disappointed to learn that all of their spotlight awards were granted to programs based on physical mobility, even though these were awarded in the midst of the pandemic. And some of the most promising virtual mobility initiatives that I have seen within the Latin American region, just to mention a few, the Organization of Catholic Universities in Latin America and in the Caribbean, or ODUCAL, they have a very robust COIL program, a very robust virtual mobility program. The Inter-American Organization of Higher Education, which Dr. Peña mentioned in her presentation earlier and that she has contributed to for many years, also has a virtual mobility space for higher education. And I'm afraid that some of these initiatives are not receiving the recognition. And why do I care about recognition? Because I really think that that these initiatives, right, have a real significance for steering opportunities. So in the interest of time, and really to turn it over for questions and for discussion, which I always think that is always much more rewarding, what I'm posing here is a question. Are we facing right now a missed opportunity for internationalizing the curriculum? And I really think one of the possible directions that we have for the future could be, first of all, recognizing that assessment and evaluation, whether we call it rankings, whether we frame it as accreditation of either programs or institutions, it has the power of steering action, right? Very often change is difficult to happen if we don't steer it in a particular way. So that's one aspect, right? The other aspect, I think, is the idea of leveraging recognition. In other words, if we are not being recognized for initiatives for internationalization at home or internationalization of the curriculum, then we need to make that recognition happen. We need to recognize each other's efforts in events like this very event, right, to bring attention to the important work that's taking place. But also, and this is maybe for discussion later on and for a future research agenda, I think right now, as we make sense of virtual internationalization, there seems to be some confusion, right? Some overlap between what we call collaborative online international learning and, of course, virtual exchange. But again, that is up for debate. I think, I really think we do ourselves a disservice if we offer these only as alternatives to physical mobility. And I think we need to be much more ambitious and to rethink internationalization for all. And I think that's the opportunity that we have in front of us. That being said, I thank you all, and I would love to stay connected. My email and LinkedIn connection informations are here, and I'm very happy to turn it over to Cassia. Thank you very much, everybody, for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Blanco. Now we've met our panel, it's time for questions and answers. Please raise your hand so the team can see you. If I see your name, I'll ask you to turn on your camera and microphone so you can ask the question of the guest speakers. You can also write your question in the chat function. Please feel free to do so at any time and the team will send it to me. I'm going to start with a question for the entire panel. How can higher education institutions benefit or differentiate themselves from internationalizing their curriculum?
Oh, I will answer that. Educational institutions, their product, let's say, it's their professionals. And having a professional that's able to think of the world, to have a broad thinking of the world, think of different perspectives, he could make a difference. That will be different than having another kind of formation. You can see it in when you have your professionals out of the university, the ones that have a curriculum, an internationalized mind, a global mind, the ones that have a different lifestyles, the one I wish that every career in my university and the whole universities in Latin America, that they could go out and have these planetary conscious, working, thinking of the ecosystem, having different ways of approaching any problem. So I love what Dr. Lee was speaking about, having Democrats and having socialists, both different or no opposite kinds of or viewing the same reality in the same country. We don't have those it's a different thing because they're not officially. You have them in culture, and culture is full of different kinds of seeing reality. But the difference is in the professionals, what they could do to really transform society and transform, I don't think, humanity. Maybe I'm a social worker, so that's why I am. So I have very big goals in that, and forming human beings. Okay, so that's what I think.
Can I add to that? It's wonderful for me to hear from my fellow panelists, Maria and Gerardo. I think you raised a lot of useful and thought-provoking points. And I particularly like Maria's response just now about the humanity. I would like to add to that. So for me, I think for an effective and beneficial approach to internationalization of the curriculum at home, perhaps we need to pay more attention to building a more integrated, reciprocal, and human approach to internationalization at home. So for me, the three pillars would appear to be quite important in the current context of the pandemic and post-pandemic. As we reflect back, we see that it is really important for internationalization to be integrated. So we can't treat internationalization of the curriculum at home, student mobility and research collaboration, or transnational education within an institution at being in silos, but these dimensions need to be integrated and be complementary to each other. So that's something that I think we need to work on, especially in this context of the pandemic. We see that there are restrictions in physical mobility, and what are the implications of virtual and hybrid mobility for internationalizing the curriculum? And and likewise, we see how transnational research collaboration can support internationalization of the curriculum, and vice versa in the case of Vietnam, as I mentioned. And the second element that I would like to emphasize is being reciprocal in internationalizing at home and international education in general. So how outbound and inbound mobility can learn from each other, how we can support international students and domestic students to be integrated and learning from each other. So it more important is what we learn from the encounter of differences rather than having the diversity or differences within the classroom. So I would like to emphasize on being reciprocal and being human in our approach to internationalization of the curriculum. And that's what being highlighted most during the pandemic when we look at the flight of international students and how they are treated across different destinations and across different states within the same country. So how we could have a more holistic and coordinated approach at the local level, at the state level, at the national level, in order to treat international students or students involved in mobility in a more human way. Thank you.
I think it has been said already, I think values matter a great deal. And I think universities, right, we need to be there front and center, making the values and the commitments that we are making, that we espouse, explicit. I think no longer we can be timid anymore about sharing and expressing these values, because I think many of these are shared across staff from and academics across the world, right? So I think we need to be very explicit in those.
Thank you so much. We have a question now from Professor Lesk. If we can get her camera and microphone turned on.
Hello, everyone, and thank you very much for the three excellent and so interesting and engaging presentations. I'm also reflecting on an earlier conversation we had this week as part of the launch of a book produced by the Centre for International Education in Brazil and the Australian Embassy. And in that discussion, we touched on some similar things, which is perhaps not surprising. But I think we also get some additional insights through putting these two discussions together. So I'd like to start by saying that I think that in the earlier discussion and in the three sections of the book, which are a discussion of pedagogy, teaching and learning curriculum, then a second section on strategy and support, and a third section on public policy, I think we often see these three things operating as silos. And so picking up on Maria Veronica's discussion, we don't see them working as a network, as we don't see them working collaboratively. Sometimes they're connected, but often they're not working collaboratively towards that same shared goal. I agree entirely that we need to really focus much more on the values, but I also think that's an area where we don't see connection always between public policy and what is happening in the classroom, what academics are wanting to do through their teaching, through the values that they're wanting to instill in their students. So until we get that thorough alignment, I think, between public policy at one end and what is happening in classrooms on the other, and the strategy and support that goes into supporting both of those and connecting all three, we're really going to be struggling to push through that very strong current thinking about internationalization that I think we see evidence of in this desire to spring back to the way things were before, because I'm not sure that governments actually want that. You know, I'm not sure that public policy wants that to happen. So my question to the panel is, how do you think we can, how can we break through? Where do we have to work? Are we working too much with each other? How can we connect and network more with public policymakers in order to see the sorts of changes that we're advocating for, and in particular, the changes in values, what higher education is all about?
Can I answer first? Yeah, okay. In Ecuador, we have community-based movement, and it's called the Mesa, it's table, the Mesa Nacional, it's the national table of values education. So it's a, how we're working now, what we're saying now, root-based from community up to the state. Why? Because we have seen that everything that comes from the policies come from governments to the people, and people, maybe it's not where they're really waiting for or searching, but the other way around, when communities arrange and we make the connections down, bottom up, it begins and it works. And why it works? In Ecuador, we began a movement before the pandemic in 2018. In one side is this Mesa of Values, and the other side is the enterprises of the, those are the leaders of the country in the other side. On the other side, we made connections with the Ministry of Education, because we think that the change is not in the universities. We have to make those connections and work in collaboration with the kindergarten from that up to the university. So we were like 12 or 20 maybe, and now we're hundreds, and we're working in that network, and that's really having its have been making changes in the connectivity, in the policies for connectivity to have education in rural areas during the pandemics. It's bottom up. And so those connections, we need leaderships. We have to don't be afraid, just go, just search, just look for someone that wants to work with you, that follows your dream. We really need transformational leaders in order to do it. And we have found 2, 3, or 5 leaders, and we worked it. And we have achievements being done. Values are transversalized in the curriculum of Ecuador right now. Remember, we have the Galapagos Islands. So sustainable, we have been learning how to be sustainable, I don't know, since I was a child, because if the Galapagos are not maintained, the world will disappear. So it's a part of a culture, of course, but I think that it's bottom up. We can do it, but making these community connections, they are down, And then someone has to go up to the floor. How do you say it in English? I don't know. My English needs to be practiced, but it's not the three hélices, but the fourth one. Maybe you, Gerardo, knows how it's the four hélices. Education or universities, the government, and I don't remember, the enterprise and community. So that's it.
Can I just add to that? I think the points you raised is really critical, Matilis, and I can't agree more with you. And I think we see the gap between the aspiration of education providers and the international education sector and policymakers is very clear, especially in the context of Australia during the pandemic. And I agree that overall, we are very good at communicating the benefits and the values of internationalization among the international education sector and among the education sector in general, like to like-minded people, but not beyond that, including to policymakers and to the broader community of the host country, for instance. And for me, I think that's certainly a very crucial task. I think there's a need to use the language and communicate the benefits and the values of internationalization in a way that aligns with the goals and the policy and practices of the particular government portfolio that we want to communicate with. So how international education can have enhanced the goals or the aspiration of the portfolio that policymaker is particularly in charge of. But I also think it's really important to have an effective leader that is able to coordinate among different departments of the government. For instance, in the context of Australia is the Department of Education, Migration, Home Affairs, Tourism, for instance, that are involved in international education. So I from my observation, we seem to lack that coordination, and we need a champion, an effective leader that are able to talk about international education in the language that aligns with the goals and aspiration of policymakers, but also to facilitate a more effective coordination between different policymaker portfolios or different governmental departments and different levels of the government. Thank you.
Very similar. Thank you, Betty, for that wonderful question. I was just going to say tongue in cheek. Well, we don't have that problem in the United States, but we certainly do, of course. I'm being sarcastic here because we are so polarized, right? It's so extreme where different sectors of the government continue to be so opposed. But by the way, this isn't happening just in the United States. This is happening in many parts, sadly, very much so in Latin America, especially, right? We certainly see this unfolding right now in Mexico, where the current administration there, right, seems to be going back to old ways of blaming these foreign forces for the domestic problems. You may call it economic, social, and so on and so forth, violence, etc. Right? Sort of this idea like many of the discourses, right, of emancipation, decolonization, and anti-imperialism sometimes are twisted, right, in ways that actually lead to isolation, xenophobia, and anti-immigration sentiments, right? So when we talk about values, we're talking about very powerful ideas that unfortunately are very easy to twist and to use against, right, the very purposes that we are trying to advance. And the one contribution that we can make as academics is that maybe we need to listen more, we need to understand what different sectors of society are looking for, because many of us happen to be in highly privileged positions to at least understand, right? Many sectors of the society are not in a position to understand because they're simply looking to survive. And I know being in university today feels like we're just trying to survive. But when we look around, when we look beyond the university, I think we are in a privileged position to try to understand even those arguments that we may find completely off-putting, if not repugnant altogether.
Thank you so much, everyone, for your answer, and to you, Betty, for your question. We have one last question. We've already run a bit over time. From Dr. Whitsed, if I can get you to limit your answers to a couple of minutes, that would be fantastic. So from Craig, thank you all for three fantastic presentations. How might we better support our staff, professional, administrative, and faculty to develop that global mindset?
I can try to go first since I'll have the most modest contribution here. I really think one of the pieces that has inspired me lately, right, is just how much more willing we have been, many of us at least during the pandemic, to recognize our shortcomings and our humanity and the challenges that we face day to day. It would be a very significant missed opportunity if we didn't use our longing for connection, the nostalgia we feel for traveling and seeing family and friends who may happen to live far away from us. Certainly that is the case with me as a transnational academic. So I really think we need to utilize more strategically the power of emotions, right? This tendency to be connected, but also this ability that we have rediscovered to connect with people that we have not even met in person at all, but that are experiencing similar challenges as the ones that we face. If we are able to inspire our colleagues and our students to seek that human connection, that networking, that Maria Veronica was telling us about, I really think we can make some progress. It's not a solution that will fix everything, but I think we would be really missing the point if we don't grasp that power of emotion and the need for connection that we're experiencing after almost 2 years now of total deprivation.
I
think Gerardo has just answered the question beautifully, and I just want to echo what he just said, and perhaps to emphasize the points about the importance of human to human experiences, human to human connection, and human to human empathy. That we should embrace, and we should pay more attention in designing professional learning program for our professional as well as academic staff in the space of internationalization, but also in education in general. And you know, what kind of activities and practices that can have a develop those capacity more effectively which is really, really important, because as Corrado mentioned, the pandemic has have to be more aware more than ever before the importance of human to human connection and experiences. Thank you.
Well, I will add something different from another part. Mental or global mind. So we're thinking outside of our borders, but sometimes our people, the ones that are inside our universities, the staff, they have a different cosmovision on the other side of the hallway, because all of our countries in Latin America, and I don't know if all, but most of them, we have our ancestral cultures, and we have our, and it's so nice that interculturally habits, ideas, etc., there are maybe sitting next to me when I have some work from it. We are, Ecuador is a pluricultural and multinational country. So exploring with them, how do you think they see the world? How do I make, I'm a therapist. So I'm a systemic therapist. So I'm trained to do that. There's people that really want to open their minds to participate, and they feel that they don't have the strength, but they do. They do because they know a part of the world that I don't, because I didn't have that opportunity, or I was not born in that part of the maybe the other side of the street, but they have a different cultural, and that's internationalization, given a intercultural. International and interdisciplinary light to thinking of a problem or solving the world problems. So faculty, they can do it. Just tell them that they are different and that they have something special to share, and they have to share it. And you will have thousands of champions inside your universities. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And what a fantastic discussion to end up on. We hope that the topics discussed have given you all new ideas to advance the internationalization of curriculum at home and in your institutions. I'd like to remind everyone that if you want to get a certificate of attendance for this event, please click on the link we have sent in the chat function. We'd also like to invite you to visit the IOC Latin American website, available in English, Spanish, and Portuguese. The link will be provided in the chat function now. It is important to highlight that soon the websites will be updated with new information and resources at no charge, and we'll send you an email when this happens. Once again, thank you, Dr. Tran, Dr. Pena, and Dr. Blanco, and everyone who's been with us here today. If you have any further questions or comments to make, please send us an email. And I saw Carla just put that in the chat function before. We hope to see you again soon, and have a nice evening for those in Brazil, or a nice day for those in Australia and on the other side of the world, depending on where you are. Thank you so much.